Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Thank you for having me. It's a pleasure to be here. We never pass up an opportunity to come. It's a fifth time. I will talk about some classical techniques and how classical techniques can be adapted to work in the cloud. As cloud is coming, and many of us working in objects and distributed stores are asking, how should a data store look, the one that is behind the cloud, behind Facebook, behind a service? We feel that actually we're not the first. Many people made the observation that the classical database is really not the right model, that it sort of gives you too much and too little. And many view it as an opportunity to actually open up the box and see how we can adapt it and make it right. And one of the things that I was looking at was at concurrency control. And concurrency control is really kind of a basic piece of a data store. And one of the things that seemed clear that different applications may need different concurrency control protocols. And today you basically are stuck with whatever the system gives you. And so we're trying to figure out how to be more flexible. And it turns out that you don't have to do anything. So I will tell you a long way around that you can get quite a bit if you don't do too much. And then tomorrow, I will talk about a different part of, again, adapting a transactional system. How should you go if you do need to change? What is the minimal amount of work you can get away with? So the idea is to figure out, you know, what is the little possible that you can change and still get what you want to get. That's sort of our motto. All right. So applications, as I said, are really moving to the cloud, and old ones and new ones, everyone wants to be there. And users want the applications to run everywhere. So I want it to run on my MacBook, and I want on my iPhone and my iPad, and kind of would like to be it all seamless. And for developers, on one hand, the cloud is a real democracy. You can get resources. You can rent them from Amazon or Microsoft, or providers come. Again, there are many platforms. There is App Engine. Maybe you want to develop on Android. Maybe you want to develop for App Store. So it empowers the developers. But with all this sort of new opportunities, challenges remain. And the challenges are kind of similar to what they were before. You still need to be fault tolerant. You want predictable performance. You want to detect intrusions. You want to predict the future. So developers need tools. And so you want, A, let them use the tools that they know. And B, you want build new tools. And the question is how to adapt old tools and develop new tools. So transactions are a really tried and true tool that makes the developer's life easier. Invented long time ago by Gray and Lemay. You heard about them already. They were even used for hardware, but they really were born in the database world. And here is a proverbial transaction. If you ever took a class on transactions, you have seen this one, right? You want to transfer money from account A to account B, and you want to make sure that either your transfer completed, you have the money in the new account, or nothing happened, but you really don't want to have halfway, like money from my account disappeared, and my partner didn't get it. Okay, so that's how it looks, and then the text looks like this. Begin, usually there is some kind of a text, transfer money, and at the end, the user gets to say, commit, I am done. Now I want to happen. Until the user said commit, it should not happen yet. But once it said commit, but of course the user can also say, oh, I changed my mind. I don't want to rent this car. I don't want this hotel room. Then the user will say abort. And then the transaction should not happen. Now, transactions provide those properties that called ACID, in short, that consist of, they really have like a four properties. I will review them. If everything is known, you should kind of tell me I'm going too slow, adjust the speed. Or if I go too fast, so they just adjust that. But so there are four intertwined properties. Atomicity, which guarantees the transaction happens, they never partly commit, right, as we said. Either everything happens or nothing happens. Even though it may crash halfway, right? Maybe halfway something bad happens, still everything must happen either completely or none. And what guarantees that is a recovery protocol. So we'll talk a little bit about the recovery protocol. So the system runs a recovery protocol, and the recovery protocol actually cooperates with the concurrency control protocol. The second property is consistency. Each transaction moves the state of the database, your data set, from one consistent state to another consistent state. The one who is responsible for this property is the developer, the person who writes the code for the transactions. Right? It makes sure that if there is a precondition that holds on your data set, some invariants hold, after you finish the transaction, the invariants will hold again. Isolation is a property that guarantees that when your transaction that developer wrote runs, it will see the effect of other transactions only at the end of the transaction. In other words, it will not see halfway state of other transaction running. And concurrency control is the protocol that guarantees that. And then durability is a property that ensures that when the user said commit and the system said okay, then even though the system may crash, the effects of the transactions are durable. Right? So even immediately after the system crashed, once the system said okay, the effects are durable. Okay, so let's talk about isolation, because that's the... So isolation means that operations are serializable. Now, to talk about serializability, we need to talk about schedules, because serializability guarantees is achieved by the system, by the scheduler of the system, allowing certain executions. So what is a schedule? A schedule of certain transactions is serializable if its effects are essentially the same as if you were running the transactions one at a time. Now, of course, you could just, how do you get that? You could run them one at a time, but that would be slow. So actually, when transactions run, they can be interleaved for concurrency. But the requirement for isolation, for serializability, constrains what schedules are allowed. So, for example, if you have two transactions, T1 and T2, they could be arbitrarily interleaved. In other words, the schedulers can do whatever it wants for the operations that comprise the transaction if there is no conflict between the operations. Now, so in a moment, I will define what is a conflict. Okay, so a conflict exists if two transactions access the same object, the same item, and one of the accesses are a write. So for example, one transaction may read an object and another transaction may write an object. Those two accesses are conflicting. Or maybe one of them writes and another writes too. So if the system does not provide serializability, then various anomalies can occur. So I would like to go over the anomalies to see and develop a little bit of intuition what they are, because what isolation is going to, serializability is going to guarantee is that those anomalies do not occur. And in fact, there is a proof that if those anomalies do not occur, then we have serializability. So one of the problems, say I have two transactions, T and S. T is my proverbial transaction that transfers from $100 from account A to account C. We will denote the operation that transaction does as reads. So in order to execute this transaction, the system is going to read from account A, then write to the account A. This is taking out the account. So it reads how much was money in account A, subtracts, and then updates account A. At this point, account A has $100 less. Then it reads the account C and adds to it the $100 and writes C back. So there are reads and writes. And then a concurrent transaction S also tries to transfer money into the same account from a different account. So again, it reads B, writes B, reads C, and writes C. If the system allows an execution where first the transaction operations of transaction S are arranged in such a way that both S and T read the same amount, read the same account C, one after the other, then transaction T updates C, and then transaction S updates C. What's going to happen is that whatever amount transaction T added will be lost because transaction S overrides that. Right? What happened? So this anomaly is called the lost update. What happened? They both read the same amount. One of them updated, and the second one immediately updated what it was. The other anomaly, so clearly that's a wrong order. That's an anomaly. It should not be happening. The second anomaly is called dirty reads. Here, what's going to happen? Again, we have our old transaction T that transfers amount. I read account A, I write account A, I read account C, transfer. And in the meantime, transaction S runs, and all it wants to do is compute the balance of the system in all the accounts. So what it does, it reads A after already $100 have been withdrawn from A. So it reads the amount, let's say initial amount was 200 minus 100, it reads 100. Then before it goes and reads, and then it goes and reads C before the second transaction, the first transaction that transfers the money, updates C. So what happened with transaction S, that it read a midway state of transaction T, it read it before A, before the after the transfer happened from A, but C before the transfer completed. And so if the system has an invariant of money, how much money there is in account, somehow things have to sum up for all the operations that happen during the day, the result of summing up, computing the total balance, will not be correct. It will show as if the money was never transferred to C because it was read too early. So this is called what happens. Transaction C here is reading dirty data. It reads data in the middle of another transaction, not at the end. And then the third anomaly is non-repeatable reads. This one is a transaction starts running. It reads some value, some object. And then as it runs, the object changes kind of underneath it. And so when it reads it again, it's not what it expected it to be. So here, again, transaction T runs the same operation, but S wants to check the balance. And if the balance, say, is above certain amount, it wants to withdraw. So say if a balance is not zero, then we want to withdraw. So transaction S reads the account A, checks that it's not, that it's above 100, say. So it assumes, as a programmer when he was writing the transaction code, it assumed that now it's safe to withdraw. But what happened that the concurrent transaction, in the meantime, the one that transferred $100 out of the account. And so when our transaction is going to continue and withdraw, it actually acts, it again reads A in order to subtract the amount, it actually now reads $100 less. And so even though it read here and checked that the condition for the operation holds, in the end, it ends up with an account not what the developer was expecting when he wrote, if there is more than $100, then subtract $100. So this is called unrepeatable read. And there is a proof that any system that is, if you don't get those anomalies, then you get a serializable execution, and the other way around. If you have a serializable execution, you will never see those anomalies. Okay, so let's talk about how do we get serializable schedules. So a schedule is a partial order of operations that satisfies the following properties. The following orders are valid orders. Operations that are within a single transaction, they should appear in the same order as the text says, right? So individual transaction operations should appear in the order of the text of the transaction. The schedule constrains, it specifies the order for operations that are conflicting. Some operations which are non-conflicting do not have to be, their order doesn't have to be specified, therefore it's a partial order. Now, any two schedules that order two conflicting operations in the same, all the conflicting operations in the same way are considered to be equivalent. Right? So we don't care about ordering of non-conflicting operations as long as our local operations within a single transaction appear in the right order. And so now we have a definition which says a schedule for a group of transactions is serializable if it is equivalent to some serial schedule. In other words, a schedule where all the operations of one transaction run, after that all operations of the second transaction run, and so on. So a correct scheduler, a correct set to give you serializability, should always order, should only produce schedules which are equivalent to some serial schedule. So for example, if we have transaction TNS like we had in a previous example, a serial schedule always orders conflicting operations. Say it orders T before S. So any serializable scheduler should give you, the producer serializable execution should give you equivalent executions. And so let's look how do the schedules look if they're produced by serializable executions. So here are previous anomalies. So first, let's look at lost update program. So if T so S transfers we have the same transactions, two transactions, T transfers from A to C, S transfers from B to C. Now a serializable schedule is one where both the read of C and the write of C is happening. Both of them are ordered after the conflicting operations with T, right? The conflicting operations here are the write of C and the read of C and the both writes of C. So here you see both the read of C and write of C are both ordered the same way with respect to the transaction T. Is that clear? So in this case, we don't have a problem. We don't lose an update because C gets to see the final result of transfer. So actually, you will get, in the end, C will have the result of both transfer from A and from B. Let's look at inconsistent retrieval. So here again, our problem beforehand was that we saw operation midway. Here, the system is allowed, right? So we're now computing the balance. We have transfer from A to C, and then our balance tries to read from A and C. Now, the conflicting operations are the read of A and the write of A, and then the read of C and the write of C. And since the schedule orders, in this case, the read after the write, and here the read after the write, this is a serializable execution. And you see there is no problem because we're picking up both updates. So if the system didn't change the amount of money that was, the transaction didn't change the total amount of money, and indeed the balance will show that because it picks up the result after. Okay, and then if you have, again, for the non-repeatable read, as you can now probably see easily, the same holds. One system out, my T transaction again transfers money from A to C, and in the meantime, the other transaction, is all our operations are ordered again after. So read and write are ordered after the conflicting operation, which is writing of A, all of them. So here, after write was already, A was already updated, I'm reading A, I'm checking that the balance is correct, and then I will only subtract, I will only transfer the, if indeed the condition held here, the result will be correct here. you get serializable executions? So you probably all know what is the simplest way of getting serializable executions in a data store. What is the magic word? What do I need? What should I do? Lock, right? Exactly. I should do some locking. Locking is one possibility. So how do lock, does lock work? Locking work. I wanted to show you something before that, before we go to do locking. Don't notice, here is an example where in this case, what my transactions do, one of them decrements, so it basically does a transfer, right? And the other one is also increments. But look, if you look carefully at this execution, here, even though this schedule looks like it is not serializable, because the conflicting transaction, the transaction that conflicts, the operation that conflicts with A here, is ordered before the operation that of transaction T1, so T2 conflicting operation, this operation is ordered before transaction conflicting operation T1, and the conflicting operation T of that accesses B of T2 are ordered after the operations of T1. So they're clearly not, this is not a serializable schedule. Even though the schedule is not serializable, notice that we don't really have a problem, because after I incremented B, right, so first we subtract from B, then we add to B. Even though they're ordered not in a serializable order, the effect of this transaction actually will be exactly the same if it runs in a serial order, right? And why is that? Because increment and decrement are actually commutative operations. So it doesn't really matter in what order they do. However, notice that the scheduler, in other words, the part of the system that orders the operations, doesn't know about that. So the system would have to, it is not allowed to produce this order. Okay, so let's look now quickly at concurrency control, right? So there are the simplest way, as we said, to get serializable execution is just run them one after another. Too slow, nobody would like to do that. So the other is pessimistic concurrency control, and you already said two-phase locking is a classical concurrency control algorithm. Basically, we use locks. Another possibility is optimistic concurrency control. Here, we proceed as if nothing is happening. You already heard about it. Transactional memory uses such a protocol. And the system has to check then whether conflicts have happened. If no conflict has happened, everything is fine. If conflict happened, the system has to recover. Usually, the way you recover is you abort, undo results of one transaction, and then redo it. And then there are other possibilities, like some kind of combinations and type-specific concurrency control as well. So let's talk about locking. So how does locking work? That's pretty simple, right? Basically, before you access each data item, you acquire a lock. The system usually acquires it for that. If you talk about database system, the moment database system sees a read access or a write access, it acquires appropriate lock. And then you don't release the locks. You cannot acquire after release. In other words, first you acquire all the locks, and only after you have all the locks, you're allowed to release them. So there is an acquiring phase, and then there is a release phase. And so the system has to hold the locks at least until all the locks are acquired. And this is called two-phase locking. And it's important to understand why you need the two-phase, because if you wouldn't do that, if, for example, you would let and release the locks before while still acquiring, you could get illegal schedules. Like, for example, here, if transaction S, again, we have the same transactions where the one with a transfer and one that computes the balance, right? T transfers money, S computes the balance of A and C. Say S acquires the lock first, then releases the lock because it doesn't need lock A anymore. And then transaction T gets the lock A, subtracts from account A, adds to account C, acquiring locks, then finishes and releases the locks. Now our transaction can get lock C, and notice what we have is a non-serializable schedule because we get to see A is ordered before conflicting operations here, but C is ordered after conflicting operations. And so you get a non-serializable schedule. It's the same if you if first T goes, finishes using A, right, acquires the lock here, releases the lock, in the meantime S comes in, grabs lock A, grabs lock C, finishes, releases the lock, then T runs. In other words, we really don't get a serializable behavior if we don't truly obey two-phase locking. Okay, so that was serializability. If a system behaves as a good citizen, if it acquires locks in two-phase locking, it can guarantee the isolation property. Now, in order to have the full asset, it also has to guarantee, as we said, atomicity. So how do we get atomicity? We need a recovery protocol. Let's talk quickly through a recovery protocol. So here is the model. The model is the data in a data store lives on disk. Disk is persistent, right? Data survives crashes on disk. But the computation is happening in memory. So if the system crashes, then all the computations in memory are erased, and the system needs to recover. So A requires a recovery protocol that even in the presence of those crashes, we still get everything or nothing behavior. So what is the idea behind recovery? So if you, again, if you studied your basic, took your database class, you know that logging is the key sort of mechanism. Basically, the key idea is you never modify your last, you never override your only copy, right? So logging is a mechanism that where you kind of scribble on the side the changes made by the transaction without actually overwriting your only copy that is on disk. So for every update the transaction issues, the system is going to write a record that contains a redo and undo, in most general case. So write it into a log. So log is really an ordered list of those redo and undo actions that correspond to the operations that transaction has performed. Right? So every operation has a redo undo action record, looks like that. It includes transaction ID, old data, new data. When the system transaction completes, the system records a commit action, if it really issued a commit. And what the commit does, that's what the trick, where the trick of recovery is. The commit actually turns those multiple updates that were happening, the transaction issued, into one single atomic write. The moment transaction wrote the record into the log is persistent, that single write basically commits, makes the operation, the entire transaction, atomic. So the rule that you need to follow, though, is write-ahead logging, right? So it's important that in order to ensure atomicity, that you must write the system, must write the log records before it modifies the data on disk. Why is that? Otherwise, you may modify your only copy on disk, and then if you didn't write the log, you will not be able to figure out how to undo it, right? So the system must write first the log record that allows it to correct in case of abort, and then it only allowed to write to disk. And the other thing that write-ahead log protocol requires, that you must force all the log records have to be on disk before the system actually commits. In other words, before it told the user, okay. Why is that? Because only then it can guarantee that even if the things crash immediately after the system said okay, you can still, you have a persistent copy in the log. So one guarantees atomicity, right? The ability, the fact that we first write to the log and only then modify guarantees atomicity. We can always undo if the system crashed halfway. And two, guarantees durability. This is the D, this is the guarantee that after the system said okay, it indeed will be durable even if you crash. And then, in addition, after the system wrote the updates to the log, it's going to update, move the updates to the disk actually lazily. It doesn't have to move them at commit. And that guarantees good performance. And I wrote performance with big letter because even though when you talk about transactions, the first things everybody will explain to you is the ACID properties, but actually performance is a not less important feature that transactional systems really are after. And lots of complexity that has in transactional system really has to do with performance. So this was sort of kind of basic sort of protocols of transactional system. One thing that is left to do is, so I told you how, what happens in normal case, how transaction commits. It tries to the log, writes commit, then propagates updates lazily. I told you what happens if it crashes halfway. Our protocol has to, you will use recovery. We'll look in a moment exactly what's happening. But a third case is what happens if transaction itself said, if the user said, oops, I don't want to do anymore. Then the system just simply can use the log to undo all the actions that were done up till now and continue as if nothing happened, right? In memory, it doesn't have to. But it writes the log, the abort record. Okay, so what happened after crash? Basically, you go over the log and then see you look for transactions that committed, right? Who are those transactions? Those are the ones that fit, who have a record in the log that has a transaction ID with a commit ending. And who are transactions that aborted are the ones that started running but don't have a commit record at the end. So for transactions that committed, their updates have to be redone. They have to be propagated to disk. And transactions who don't have the record, the commit record at the end, their effects have to be undone. But the log has enough information inside to undo all the effects, right? So if you just go and roll back the effects. So this guarantees that after system starts from the crash, any update that got propagated to the database for, by transactions that did not commit will be erased. So I hope that at least for those who haven't looked carefully into transactional system implementations, you have a basic idea how those mechanisms work, right? One of them guarantees the concurrency control guarantees that the effect of running the transactions is as if they were running one at a time, even though they do not run at one at a time. They're interleaved, so locking guarantees. And the recovery protocol guarantees that even though you may have propagated effects, the system may have propagated effects to the disk halfway and transaction crashed, all the half-done effects can be undone, so that you really do have ultimately the promise that either you completed the transaction completes in full or nothing happened. So that's sort of the basic tutorial on transactions you have. Now, let's look what happens in a distributed system. So in a distributed system, I have servers running somewhere in a data center. They hold the data, so the data lives somewhere reliably in an internet data center. And then clients access the data, the master copies, the servers, fetch data, and compute. So think about your iPhone. Right? Compute, performs some kind of computation, and then puts the updates back in the data center, into the servers in the data server, so that if two clients share data, they can see each other's updates, right, through by fetching the results. Now, let's look at locking in this context. So locking has a number of disadvantages in this context. Because first, you have to acquire the lock even if there may not be any conflict, right? So acquiring a lock means you have to go to the data center. So this is, you know, latency. And then there is an overhead. Now, if the locks are very fine, like, so that they can avoid conflicts well, then you have to go often to acquire them. If the locks are coarse, on the other hand, so you have the standard trade-off, then you may have conflicts. So you will have to abort. In other words, you will have to do it again. Notice that two-phase locking makes things even worse, because now you have to hold the locks for longer time, which means that somebody else who wants the same data cannot get there. And in addition, if some holder of the lock is unavailable currently because maybe they have a network partition, then nobody can actually get to the object. So if you have a common account, you cannot get both to it. So locking in this context is really suboptimal. It's not a good mechanism for concurrency control. So instead, a much more appealing concurrency control scheme is optimistic concurrency control scheme. It sort of follows this maxim that it's better to apologize if bad things happen than ask permission when maybe there is no need to ask permission, right? So optimistic concurrency control does not do locking, skips all the locking, but it tries to look, it makes sure that it can detect the conflict. So let's look at a basic optimistic concurrency control scheme. If you look inside, There is basically two questions that an optimistic concurrency control scheme has to answer. How should the system detect a conflict? And the second question is, well, what do you do when you detect a conflict? So how should the system detect a conflict? Remember our two transactions, transaction T, transaction S. One transaction tries to transfer money from one account to another. Another transaction tries to maybe sum up the balance. What does it mean? When do we have a conflict? So if transaction T came to commit, there was a conflict if a conflicting transaction committed that was running while my transaction was running, committed while I was running. Because that means that my transaction has seen both the effects before the transaction finished, and it also sees what happened after transaction, some other transaction finished. So what a validation mechanism should ensure that this is not the case. In other words, T, my transaction T that I'm about to validate, should not commit with any transaction S that commits while I am in progress. So while I'm running, I should not be conflicting with transactions that was committing while I'm in progress. And then what do you do if a conflict is detected? In other words, we detected transactions that committed while I was in progress. Well, then one of those transactions have to be erased from the system, its effects. So it better be me, because that other transaction has already committed. So the validation occurs in optimistic concurrency control at the time the transaction comes to commit. And it has to check whether there were any conflicts with transactions that were previously validated. So here is a simple validation method. The method is simple because I will go to make some simplifying assumptions. A transaction that runs, it updates its private copy only. So until it comes to commit, nobody sees any effect of my transaction. Right? So if I'm holding, me, the client is holding and not showing any effect to the system, indeed nobody will see those effects. So transactions hold their tentative copies. So if updates from T, from my transaction T, are not visible to transaction S that could potentially be committing while I'm running until the end, I only have to worry about transaction T, whether it conflicted with anybody that committed. I don't have to worry about S anymore. And the other simplifying assumption, let's for a moment assume that the commits are all violated in serial, and they violate and commit at a central point. So then the transaction manager, what it needs to do, it has to keep for each transaction its read set, what object it read, and what object it has modified, so R of T and W of T. And T, since T cannot affect any S that committed before T, we only need to see whether T has seen all the writes by S. Does that make sense? Again, I made the assumption, right, that any transaction does not show its effect until it commits. And I'm talking about two transactions. I'm about to, transaction T that is about to commit, and I'm worried about any transaction S that committed while I was in progress. So the system just has to worry about T, about me trying to commit, because any transaction S that was running didn't see my changes. I am not showing my changes. Right? I'm holding them in a tentative place. So all we need to know is whether T has seen writes. If T has seen the writes, you know, before, if it hasn't seen any writes, then we are actually, right, so let's just go over protocol in more detail. So when T asks to commit, right, we need to check for conflicts for any previously validated transactions. So we look at transactions that committed before my transaction started. Those that committed before T starts, they're fine, because my transaction sees their effects. I'm running after them. So no problem. T sees their effects. I have to check that my transaction, in other words, whatever I read, should not conflict with any rights that another transaction made. If what I read was written by a transaction that was running concurrently, then that's a problem, because I could not have read what they read, what they wrote, right? So it's a conflict. So if T might not have seen those writes, it cannot be serialized. If it's seen those writes, if we would know and everything happened after, that would be fine, but we don't know, because it was running while we were computing. So if we haven't seen, then that's a problem. So therefore, the system has to keep the write sets of transactions that validate on something called the validation queue. And when I validate T, the system simply checks that my read set does not conflict with a write set of transactions that was has been validated. And if it does conflict, then I get restarted. In other words, I'm not allowed to put my changes into the system back, and I have to refetch the values anew and start again. Does that make sense? Okay, so now, yes. Exactly. Yes, right. So as you will see in a moment, that is a bit of a problem, right? Especially if what I really would like to do, the transactions that run in a distributed system, for performance reasons, they would like to cache elements on which they compute, right? So here, I would like to make the system more scalable. In other words, let's say I fetched some element X from the server, and now I'm computing on it. I would like to keep it instead of each time I need to compute new transaction, go and refetch it, right? So to get better performance, why does it give me better performance? A, I save latency of going and fetching the object again. B, there is less load on the server, because anything that I don't fetch, I avoid the server doing extra work. So the system is clearly more scalable and performs better if the clients are allowed to cache objects and compute on cached objects. But then when I go to validate, right, so now the model looks like this. The clients go fetch elements, fetch objects, keep them in the cache, compute with them. When they want to commit a transaction, then they go back and validate. But now that the clients can keep transactions for a long time, now we have the objects for a long time. Now, in order to detect whether my read set conflicts with any transaction that was running while I'm committing, whether my read set conflicts with any write of a transaction that was validated, the validation queue has to be very long. It has to keep basically the entire history, right? Because I can keep for the cached objects for a very long time. How do I know that they're, so to speak, not stale? They are not stale if nobody committed anything. But how do I know that nobody committed anything? I have to go to the validation queue and check that no transaction write set contains what I read. So this method does not work very well because the validation queue has to be sort of infinite. So we need some improvement. So actually, the way those systems work, they don't really make the validation queue infinite, but instead, what they do, right? So, as I just explained, there is no guarantee if I cache that T observes the writes by S, unless that committed before T started, unless the validation queue is infinite. So what those systems do instead is they have this cache coherency protocol that actually takes care of informing the clients about data that has objects that they cache, but they have changed, right? So the key idea here is that the server is going to keep track of who caches what, roughly. Right? So anytime the client asks for an object from the server keeps track of that. It knows that client I has cached those objects. Anytime any transaction commits a modification to object X, the server looks who are the clients that cache object X, and then makes a note that this client has a callback. They have an invalid object. They have a stale version because a new version was just committed. Right, so any time S has modified an object X that my client caches, there is a callback from the server to the client saying, invalidate your copy. And the client who received a callback has to abort transaction, any transaction that has X in its read set. Now, if the client has not, if the transaction that client runs does not have X in the read set, there is no problem. You don't need to abort anything. The only thing the client needs to do is to mark that object as invalid. But if a transaction was in progress that already read X and is currently running, an invalidation arrives, that means that transaction has to abort. It has read a stale version, right? It has observed values in between. The transaction already, those values are not new anymore, not fresh anymore, and so it has to abort. Now, the callback, right, this notification to client is held in the invalid set until the client says, acknowledges the invalidation. In other words, until the client says, okay, I have seen that. The moment the client said, I have seen that invalidation, the server says, okay, it can remove the callback and everything is okay. It's the responsibility of the client after he says, okay, not to keep anymore the invalid version. So if a now, obviously, invalidation, there may be a race condition. The client, the server is sending a callback. In the meantime, the client is trying to commit. So the rule is that a transaction T from client S will fail validation if at the time that is validating at the server, there is a callback which says fork object X, and that object X is in the transaction read set, right? So if there was a race condition so that the client comes to validate a transaction and that has X in a read set, and the server in the meantime has a callback, they're waiting for the client for that object, then the transaction has to abort. So so this is sort of a basic, this is a basic optimistic concurrency control scheme for clients that run, for a distributed client server system where the clients cache objects. Now, consider one step forward. Imagine clients can disconnect, right? So if clients can disconnect, then from the point of view of the server, it is as if the transactions that are running at, on the client, they run for a very long time, right? So so how does this system work? So this system is, again, it's similar to the system we looked before. However, the only difference is that after clients fetch the objects and compute, they disconnect and can run for a long time until they come and reconnect. Maybe the network is down. Maybe they don't want to use the network because it's expensive, because it's overseas. So how would this system work? So here, the key idea is, since client is disconnected and it cannot really go and validate while it's disconnected, it's going to run tentative transactions, right? So the client runs a transaction, and when it transaction finishes and the program says commit, the client is going to do what's called a tentative commit of T. It's going to collect locally a read set and a write set of that transaction to a tentative transaction log. Now, in the meantime, the server accumulates those callbacks, right? Because client is disconnected, the server keeps track of the callbacks. When the client finally reconnects with this tentative log of transactions that committed tentatively, it starts validating the transactions, and the validation rules are actually similar, right? Any tentative transaction that the disconnected client has executed that has some X in its read set, such that that X is an invalid set for that client, has to abort. Or also, if the X is in has been if a transaction is read, result of a transaction that already has aborted. So what's happening here, that when the client is running those tentative transactions, it's, say it commits a modification to some object, it read some X and computed some Y, the next transaction that it commits may have read Y. If transaction, when I validate transaction X that read X, turns out that it needs to abort, then the transaction that read the result of X also has to abort, right? That's called a dependent abort. So the validation procedure simply goes over the log and checks that any transaction, tentative transaction, doesn't have some X in invalidation list with a callback, or it has not read from a transaction that already aborted. In other words, its rights is actually not valid because it had read from an invalid object. And then the remaining operations, the remaining tentative transactions, those that did not read invalid objects and did not read from transactions that aborted, those can all commit. Right? And their results will be staying at the server, generating new callbacks for anybody who cached the objects that these transactions modified. And the client, whose transactions were just validated and got aborted because they read invalid, has to refetch new values and resubmit operations. So this is a basic scheme for validating disconnected transactions, right? The difference between disconnected and connected, that a disconnected client commits a series of tentative transactions and then validates them all at once. Yes. Yes, it can read from the cache, and it can read any object that it itself modified. If it wants to read and it's not in the cache, then the only thing it can do is either abort that transaction, because if it cannot reconnect home, or it has to reconnect to the server somehow. Maybe it can, you know, use more expensive bandwidth and reconnect. Ultimately, there, you know, it's likely there is other bandwidth, but for various reasons, you may decide you cannot or don't want to reconnect. At some point, if you want the paper that you want to work on submission deadline, you have to reconnect home and get it. Right? There is no choice. So is it a good moment to do a break? I'm trying to remember. I think we start at 3:30, right? So that may be a good moment. Let me just think before I let you go. So let me just point out a problem with optimistic concurrency control, and then we can break. So that'll be a good moment. So the problem with optimistic concurrency control, we already talked about the problem with locking, right? Locking is inefficient. So the problem with optimistic concurrency control is that, you know, it's easy to read to do the validation. I bet you everybody can code with the validation procedure. It's pretty simple. If there is no concurrency, you can commit. Now, if there are complex transactions, you have to abort. And the effects have to roll back. And the clients really don't like so much abort the work that they have done. So some systems try to reconcile the changes. It's a bit like, imagine you made an update and your colleague made an update on the same paper, and you need to reconcile the changes. Now, usually this reconciliation, you have to ask the client what to do, and they don't like that. It's complicated, and it's hard, and really everybody is unhappy about that. So even though when there is no conflict, the optimistic scheme is really appealing. When there are conflicts, it's really unappealing. It has a problem. So here we are, right? You can do either locking or optimistic concurrency control. And the bad news, they both have problems. So the good news are after 10 minutes, after 5 minutes break. All right. Yeah. All right. So welcome back, everybody. Who happy to see still somebody here. Okay. So we talked about before the break about we kind of briefly, you know, on one foot I led you through the database basic theory, transaction, concurrency control and recovery course. So actually, it's, you know, a huge time saving for you if you didn't take the class. But we see that in the end, we end up not in a very good situation because both of our techniques that we have problems. So, so what I would like to talk about now is what can we do about that, right? So, okay, so. Here is a hybrid approach, right? Here's an approach I'm going to describe that tries to overcome the limitations of both of them. So it is optimistic for the data which is private. So data where there is no conflict expected, it's optimistic, which means you don't really pay anything what you don't need to pay. You avoid conflicts by this notion of reservations for shared data. So I will explain in a moment what it is. The reservations are like special locks, but they're special, and they have a timeout. Those locks are going to exploit the object type. So they will not be applicable to any object, only of objects of particular type. And they will exploit the properties of that object to gain concurrency. And one of the properties they're going to exploit is the commutativity. I was trying to hint you about the, this type of object when I showed you the two transactions that could be serialized in a non-serializable, so to speak, scheduled in a non-serializable way, and still the two increment and decrement, because they commute, and still get the effect was okay. The result was as if they executed one after the other. So here is an example. So let's say I have a really simple example. So this is escrow type. This is the example that I'm going to use it as running example. Here is escrow type. It's an type that basically allows you to think about it like a counter. It allows you to split and merge back some amount. And here I have two clients, Joe and Mary, and this type is used to, for example, implement reservations for salesmen that are going to reserve some items for sale. So at the server, there is currently available, how many? Six items for sale. And then client Joe reserves three items and disconnects. So when he disconnects, what's left in the server are three items in stock. Right? So we're using this type to manage, implement the object in stock. Then another client called Mary gets two more, reserves two more objects. And now at the server, we just have one object left. Then Mary, who is actually a great salesman, sells those objects. Those are cars, let's say, or some other less dramatic object. And then it reconnects back, updates. So she gets some money. She reconnects back, right? Updates the server with the earned amount, commits the transaction, end of her transaction. Then the salesman Joe also sells his, uses up his reservation, selling the cars, commits the transaction, reconnects home to commit a transaction, and puts the result, you know, the resulting money updates some account. So if you look at this simple example, notice that the salesman Joe was able to commit. You could not, in a normal system that I was describing to you up till now, that checks for reads and writes conflicts, you would, salesman Joe would not be able to commit his transaction. Why? Because after he has disconnected, the copy that of data that he cached of the in-stock item has been updated by Mary. So when he reconnects, if we have would have been using the previous concurrency control optimization schema that I was talking about, a callback would be waiting for him on in-stock item. An in-stock item would be in his read set, right? Because he reads the item, and he would have to abort his transaction, right? So even in this simple example, so with conventional read-write conflict validation, this behavior would not be supported. However, it can be easily supported with a type-specific synchronization for escrow type. So escrow type is a known simple data type. Let me show you. It does just, it has two operations, split and merge. Split and merge, commute. Basically, think about them increment, decrement. Now, in 70s and 80s and 90s, there were lots of concurrency controls developed, type-specific concurrency controls, that exploit the types of the objects, right? That exploit these commutative operations. Now, why couldn't we use those type-specific concurrency control algorithms in our system? We cannot use them because the type-specific code that knows that it is okay to allow to Joe to commit and not generate a callback for him, that code lives inside the concurrency control engine of the database. Concurrency control and recovery subsystem is a highly tuned internal part of the database engine. It is not a component that is easily updatable, right? And you could, if you would be your IT manager, you would not like some random developer to put, you know, it could destabilize your system, any bug. It affects any application. So it's a no-go, right? Using those type-specific concurrency controls inside the engine that validates the transactions never worked. So despite existence of lots of work that has been put into those algorithms, they really never took off because of reliability, because of performance, because of stability considerations. So here is a new kind of a modular approach that aims at exploiting those type-specific concurrency control algorithms without actually modifying the servers. So it can run on the on top of the commodity server, which is attractive in this context. And also I will show you, it will provide you some interesting new benefits. So what do we want, right? Following our inventory example, what we would like is ability to acquire reservations so that a disconnected transaction can commit, even though other transactions concurrent using reservations on the same object were committing in between. So such a transaction can commit without conflict. If there are failures, in other words, if my laptop with reservations dropped into the Indian Ocean, then the system should be able to recover the lost reservations. Those reservations should not just simply disappear. So we should be able to support crash recovery, the system crashes between. And also, we should allow the system to find only commit the sale, so to speak, that really committed. In other words, you could allow a client to make reservations, but then change their mind and not use them. Right? You should be able to return them, so to speak. And all that without any modification to your concurrency control engine. Yes. Yes, because any time you have a disconnected client, it has cached objects, right? But any time a client is disconnected, it could crash. In other words, the system could, the client could break. Like, well, so they, those are tentative transactions. They never commit until they actually come to the server. So a tentative transaction, by definition, until it commits at the server, it's not permanent, right? They could abort anyway in general because of conflicts. Exactly. You have to commit within some time. As reservations are with timeout, so there'll be a timeout associated with that. So, okay, so. Right, so the guarantees are really very much like you got before, but you have a timeout, as you point out. So here is the system architecture, right, with the exos. So like before, the server looks exactly the same. So it has a validation queue, it caches, it tracks the invalid sets of objects that commit, right? It's all done on read-write basis. Now, the clients have two levels of transactions. There are top-level transactions. Those are the ones that for whom we are planning now to provide atomicity guarantees. They're the ones that are going to use reservations. They're going to use reservations to synchronize between concurrent clients in a type-specific way. So those high-level transactions, the top-level transactions, those are the ones that are going to be synchronized in a type-specific way. They are going to use reservation transactions. And those transactions will be running the same transactions we have been running before, whatever the system supports. Right? They're the ones that are, we talked about them a minute ago. So the system has two levels. And the servers process both transactions identically. The servers just look at generic read-write optimistic control. Remember our game, we are not allowed to change the servers, the server architecture. We're using the commodity, whatever system is running there. So, and here is what a program that mobile client executes looks like, right? It begins top-level transaction. It obtains some reservations, just like in that example I was showing you. Then it loads some objects into the cache, disconnects from the server, computes, commits tentative transactions. Because it's disconnected, everything that it commits is tentative, one after the other, right? So transaction can one transaction can compute some result based on cached objects. The next transaction will read the results that the previous transaction and keep going. They can locally validate the transactions against the reservations. That's new. So if I have a reservation, I can locally validate my transaction against those reservations. So for example, a salesman can validate, before it sells the car, it can validate a transaction that sells the car, that it really has, is able to sell that. He will not have to say, oops, sorry, right? Because it really has the reservation. Then it can connect to the server. If it needs, it can obtain new reservations or renew the reservations that it had because they are coming with a timeout. Eventually, the client wants to commit top-level transaction. It commits a top-level transaction, atomically and validates or aborts local transactions. Now, what the system guarantees that any transaction has been locally validated will be able to commit. Right? So unless the reservation timed out, anything that you validated against the reservation is guaranteed to commit. Right? So we prevent, there is no problem with asking clients to reconcile now. And so if there are any unused reservations, the client is going to release. Right? So in terms of programmer, that's a reasonable model of computation. There is really sort of nothing surprising for the client. Yes. If the local validation fails, then the client is in the same position as if he did not have a reservation, right? So, for example, if the client tries to validate a transaction that sells the car, but it so happens that the timeout has expired.
What I think is, if I have a
reservation. If you fail after validation, then this is covered under the what we require from the system. So if you fail, for example, because you know you dropped your, then the system will have to recover your reservation, right? So the system will have to take care of that. Okay. So what's inside the reservation really? So now I'm describing you how the reservation looks. So what's inside the reservation is an object of escrow type, right? That has two operations, split delta, merge delta, and a balance, which is the state of the escrow object. Notice, split and merge operations commute while the balance is positive. So this is a type, escrow type. Escrow is representative of actually a fragmentable object type. So there's a whole class of those objects called fragmentable objects whose operations commute, so we could reuse them. Now, if you look at the client-side reservation, a reservation is executed like a transaction. The client, the split operation decreases the in-stock value, and at the same time, it stores an inverse operation. So, in a local log, right, with a lease. So, for example, client Joe that reserved three items, right, it stores, it executes an operation split three, and logged an operation inverse, which is merge back three. The log itself, right, lives, it's part of the representation of the object. So object has method, state, and the log, a local log. The log and the entire object is saved, sent to the server at the time the transaction commits. So what the effect of reservation is committing this object containing the reservations and the operations in the log at the server. Right? The log is written to the server. Now, other clients, like, for example, Mary, that reconnect to the server, they get to see the value of that object. They fetch the object together with those logged operations. So they get to see the reservations made by another client. Right? This is how the sharing happens. Since they see these changes, right, they can then update their state. So this was description of escrow method called split. The method of method acquire, right, which uses split. The method release reservation calls, instead of split, it calls the merge operation of the object. So when a client that runs connects to commit a top-level transaction, right? So the client executes and well disconnect a number of transactions that are all tentative. The top-level transaction has confirmation actions, sort of like callbacks, think about it, associated. Those actions are being executed when the top-level transaction commits. And those confirmation actions take effect then. The commit of that top-level transaction makes the changes permanent. Now, what happens, right, like in our example, if when my client Joe tries to commit its top-level transaction, it finds out that in the meantime, Mary, right, has committed a reservation to the same object. Remember, in this case, in the previous scheme, the top-level transaction would have to abort because there is a callback waiting. What's happened here is when the top-level transaction commits, the system detects that the object that it's trying to commit is stale. So it informs the client, you have to abort. What the low-level system does for the client, it applies the inverse from the log. In other words, the operation that was there in the log, there is an inverse operation there. Since that operation has been just informed to abort the reservation, putting back, the client applies the inverse, refetches a new object, fresh. That object has a log with Mary's reservations. And now it applies the split operation again. Right? And can continue. This is done automatically by those confirmation actions, right? Those special actions that are attached to the body of the object. Yes.
You need to require that operations are inverted, but they don't necessarily have to commute.
Yes, they just have to have here actually they have inverses and they commute. They require this ones have to commute.
But in general you need inverses more than even if they didn't commute.
You need inverses.
You need inverses.
Yes. Yes. In this as I will show you in a moment you also need a commutativity here in this scheme. If your operations do not commute, this scheme, this particular one, will not work. Yes, this will, right, but I will show extensions that rely on that. Okay, so far, yes. That's a very good question. You can choose any period of timeout that you estimate that the client will come back. So it could be varying, yes. Exactly, it could vary. In other words, some clients may have a short timeout, some clients may have a long timeout. Ideally, you have a kind of a safe, as I will show you in a moment, what it affects. In principle, taking a big timeout, you know, overestimating timeout does no harm to the client that made the reservation, but it affects the other clients in case the client crashes. That's really the only trade-off. But if the client reconnects in time, there is no harm in having a overestimated timeout. The timeout? I think if you try to engineer the system, you would set the timeout to your expected reconnection time. So, for example, a salesman, maybe it reconnects you know, during the day, at the end of the day, normally. Or maybe, and safely, it sometimes reconnects. If the connectivity is not good, it could take it for a week. Right? So you can take it, set a timeout for a week. But as I said, there is a penalty to gross overestimation, because if the client, if in the rare case when the client truly crashes, that's not a very common case. That reservation would be unavailable until, because I will show you how you handle the timeout expiration. Okay? Yes.
So what you call a top-level transaction is not a transaction from the perspective of the underlying database.
Well, from point of view of underlying database system, from the server, right? All it sees is transactions which look all the same. No, the server doesn't know about that. As I will show you in a moment, they have properties of us. They have ACID properties by the nature of the because the low-level transactions have ACID properties, but the server doesn't know about them. They're constructed by this layer of reservations. Okay, what happens if there are failures, right? What if my client crashes and fails to reconnect? Well, what then happens, reservation expires. Other clients will notice a reservation and will clean up. What does it mean to clean up? They invoke the inverse, right? So when another client will fetch it, will see an expired reservation. This is, the recovery here is lazy. It happens when somebody else observes. Now, those confirmations, the special actions that happen when the top-level transaction commits involve the cleanup on behalf of other clients, right? So if the client invokes an object-specific confirmation actions and it observes expired leases, the cleanup happens part of the high-level transaction, of the top-level transaction commit. Right? So the client invokes the merge for the client that failed and then commits that. So let's look at the example, right? That I think will answer. So here is example. Here's my server. Initially, it had two clients, C1 and C2. Initially, the escrow, you know, the in stock was 15. Client 1 acquires, reserves 5 items. As a result of client reservation, it creates an inverse in the log of merge 5 on behalf of client 1. And the value of the client reservation of the in stock in client is 5. Now notice the value that is being sent back, the update that is being happening as a result of this reservation transaction, actually has the same value in the log, right? So we're committing object with this log. But the value is 10, right? The reminder. So the commit of the reservation transaction leaves the state at the two objects, at the server and at the reserving client, they're not the same. Makes sense, right? Because you took a reservation. Now, at some point, the client uses ZAP2, so locally it can run a split operation, which means, you know, I sell 2 cars, and can validate locally against the value. It can validate because I have the reservations. This reduces the value to 3. There is a lock, if a transaction will locally abort, there will be a return of this value, right? But this is local operation, right? So on commit, if the client top level transaction commits, then we just need to merge 3 back to return. But if it aborts, then it has to merge 5. Now, in the meantime, client 2 reserves, makes a reservation, acquires 3. His log, when he commits, includes, when he tried to commit his reservation, initially, he saw there was a callback waiting for him, right? Because C1 has committed a reservation there. So when it gets back, he really fetches the object together with a merge 5 C1, right? And then he adds merge 3C2 as a result of reservation acquire 3C2. Does that make sense? Right? This is the state that came, the merge 5 was fetched from the server, and our client added this and committed back. So then, at some point, client 1 wants to commit its top-level transaction. As part of the commit, it's going to release, right, do the merge 3. The commit manipulates the log. It deactivates the merge 5 inverse, right? That's part of the confirmation actions. That had to do on commit. So this one is saved here. What stays there, it also increased, there was some remainder. So it increases the value. That's what the merge operation did, merge 3. And notice the log still has the merge 3 inverse from other client. If other client never reconnects, if C2 ever, for example, crashed, right, then at some point, somebody would find this inverse when they fetch, and they would see there is a timeout here that it expired, and they would execute merge 3 back. Now, the question you should ask is, what happens if nobody notices the expiration? Well, they don't notice and nobody's using it, so that's not the problem. What happens if two clients notice simultaneously that they expired, right? They both try to execute merge. Well, one of them, remember, our server is validating those transactions. One of them will manage to commit first. Whoever commits first will generate a callback, so to speak, waiting for the other. So when the other will try to commit, it will not be able to commit the change because it will be waiting. It will have to abort, refetch, and then it will see that there is no more callback, no more inverse anymore. What happens, if there is commits happening, conflicts happening after the other? Well, it's for moderate contention, it's okay. What happens if the clocks are not the same? We use the server clock for the timeout. And there's always a question of security. In an appliance, it's okay, right? So if the client don't pray open their appliance, then it's all right. Okay, so what I showed you is that a two-level transaction system that changes nothing on the server side is able to, has completely generic server, runs basic optimistic concurrency control at the server, can allow application-level transaction to synchronize using those escrow objects. So the application-level transactions, those high-level, they're actually synchronizing in type-specific way. They don't abort, even though one of them makes modifications and observes data that has been modified by the other. So if you look at the asset properties, like somebody asked the question, for the high-level transactions, well, they're durable, right? The effects of the high-level transactions, they're durable because they're using low-level transactions. Low-level transactions are durable, so you get durability. The isolation and the consistency is semantic, right? Transactions do observe each other's intermittent values, but they only see those commutative operations. The effect is as if they executed one at a time. It's the same effect because transactions commute. Atomicity, it's reservations are like clocks. However, unlike clocks, the important thing here, that you must release them at commit, right? Locks in general don't need to be released at commit. They can be released later, lazily. It doesn't impact the correctness. But here, the reservations must be released at commit because if they are not released at commit, they may expire and somebody may undo, right? So the effect of transaction will not be really as promised atomic. So those reservations must be released at commit. But they can be, if you abort, you can lazily remove them. Somebody else can do it for you. Right? So that's the difference from normal locks. Now, what's interesting At the end, probably a couple of minutes and I will be done. What's interesting that, you know what? Maybe it's better to stop at the time so the students don't hate me. How does it work here? A couple more minutes or, yes? Okay. So, you know, I'm not allowed to go run over time in my school. That would be like the end. People want to go have dinner. So, okay, so, you know, there were many, so I will be fast. So server-side 80 protocols in the 80s, 90s, they all, if you look at them carefully, they look like a monitor, right? Basically, there is a shared state manipulated by monitor procedures are the ones that manipulate the shared state. And there is a mutex that protects the shared state, manipulated by the monitor procedures. What the EXO approach does, it converts such server-level, centralized, monitor-like protocols into this client-side protocols, which means we can take advantage of any one of the protocols that has this structure. And the transformation is actually really simple. All the transformation does, right, it basically, that object is being lifted and cached on the client side. The client runs the methods of the type specific on the cached copy. When it tries to update the server on commit, the server cache coherency protocol serves the role of the mutex. Right? It detects if the value of the client object is stale and forces the client to refetch the new value, the shared state. Right? So then the protocol, after you refetch, you run as if you were running on the server copy. Right? So if you look at the object implementation then, right, the implementation is generic. The object has those acquire, release, and expire operations that invoke the methods of the object inside, right? And the methods are, in this case, they were split for acquire, merge for release, plus the log of the inverse operations, right? And the internal state. So, now, I will not have time to tell you about the extra benefit now. I will tell you briefly next time. But one of the things you can do with something that you couldn't do before, because with the cached client, with the cached version of the object, essentially the client has all the synchronization logic on the client side. You can actually allow one client to serve as a server for another. So you can allow the following operation. Let's say I have some synchronization operations. I have some reservations. And you want reservations. I can give you my reservations. What's interesting, I can give you my reservations, but the system will behave, the correctness condition is as if you took it from the server and I never had it. Of course, I will have to define a recovery protocol and so on for that. But this is something that you could not do before. You could not split lock and get it from another client. Okay, so any questions now? I will stop now. Next time I will talk about the split, reservation split, and I will talk move to my next topic, which is what happens if you really need to modify transaction system. This was without modifying. Any questions? Well, if you have any questions, then can keep them, and I will be happy to answer them tomorrow. Yes?
So the logging, the persistent logging is also part of the object.
Exactly. The server doesn't know anything about the logging. The log with the inverse, it's part of the object representation. Right? Because as far as the server is concerned, the object is uninterpreted bag of bits. All it knows, the object has been modified or not.
One,
yes, is one object.
Okay.
And so all the server knows is whether that object that you are putting back, whether it is fresh, in other words, whether anybody has modified that object or not. If anybody has modified that object, you will have to first undo your inverse, you know, operation using the inverse you logged, refetch the new state, and then apply your operation again. And you are allowed to do that because those operations commute. So basically, you're ordering your operation after the operation that has commuted in the meantime and reflected in the log. Okay. Any more questions? All right, then see everybody tomorrow.